features live coverage of an African safari and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good morning and welcome on your live safari experience, starting off with elephants disappearing off into some very dense vegetation. This is Safari Dive.
Ready. Standing by.
Good morning to all of you and welcome on the Sunrise Safari. My name is Jamie. This morning I have Viam on camera with me and we are coming to you live from Juma, Arethusa and Cheetah Plains Game Reserve in the Sabi Sand in the Greater Kruger National Park area of South Africa, where all kinds of wonders await you, from the elephants that were next to us, and we almost had the perfect joke because they were all walking down the road in front of us, and since it is Monday morning here in South Africa, I was going to make the joke about it being Monday morning traffic out here in the bush. But unfortunately, they decided to move off the road just before the start of our sunrise safari. The joys of live wildlife filming mean that you can't plan anything. Oh, if you do want to send through any questions, because this is live, it means that you can interact with us. And you can do that on hashtag SafariLive on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. You finished, Franklin? No? Okay. Just wait for you to finish. Good morning, Lucian, who is watching for the first time in the morning here in South Africa, and says, won't all of the animals be sleepy? Not as sleepy as we are, but no, absolutely not. The morning is the best time to be out in the bush. Everything is wide awake. Predators are still moving about, especially on a chilly morning like this morning. It is very chilly. The cloud cover is blowing away, but I think, what is it, 16 and 63? So 16 degrees centigrade, 63 Fahrenheit, which means it's nice and cool. You've got a chance of nocturnal creatures still moving about. They might not have gone to bed yet. The birds are wide awake, singing their chorus. The elephants clearly are wide awake, and we've got all kinds of exciting things planned, much like we did yesterday on the sunset safari. How was your sunset safari yesterday, VMP?
Very nice.
What have you said? But short. We've got some spurfowl starting off. Perhaps they'll give us a part of their dawn chorus. Yesterday, we started off in a very exciting way. Viam and Brent filmed a live kill with Karula. She caught a dacre. Terribly, terribly exciting stuff. We'd just found the lions, including the lion cubs that we'd spent the whole morning looking for. Then we were going to go to Cheetah Plains to find a quarantine, which is... Oh, Ellie's are talking to each other, low rumbling. We are going to go to quarantine this morning. That's what we're going to do. He's on a kudu kill. However, the wheels all fell off, or at least in Rusty's case, pointed in opposite directions. Brent hit a stump and bent the steering bar almost to a 90 degree angle, and Jigger had no signal. So it was disastrous for a little while, but then it all came together beautifully in the end. Karula hoisted her kill into a jackalberry. I'm not going to say anymore. I do not want to ruin any of the surprises that we have planned. Speaking of Karula and her dacre kill, let's head across to Brent so that he can tell you the full story.
Well, no story just yet this morning. As you can see, the dacre is still atop the jackalberry. No sign of Karula and cubs. Now, that leads us to believe what could have happened.
And on that cold, windy night, like last night, and dark night, maybe Karula caught something else on her way to fetch the cubs. So what we're going to do is we're going to head towards where we last spotted her, around Weaver's Nest, and go check the southern boundary for tracks. We will keep checking the spot throughout the drive. Hopefully they will arrive. And if not, we'll go look for the lions. We'll see what else is out in this very chilly, wonderful part of the world.
Now,
Final Control tells me it's 16 degrees Celsius. I don't believe them. It's much colder than that. I've even got blankets on, scarf. Very cold today. And can you believe it? Rusty is even steering better than it was before our little mishap yesterday. Remember, this is live, and you can use the hashtag Safari Live or the email address questions@wildearth.tv to send us any questions or comments. So to tell you what happened yesterday, well, let's start in the beginning. We got a report that Tundi, a female leopard, was heading towards the southeast in a corner of Juma. As we got there and we saw the leopard, I said, that doesn't look like Tundi, that looks like her mother. And it was Queen Karula. And we followed her as she unsuccessfully hunted for the majority of the sunrise safari. Then we set about to look for her on the sunset safari, and no sign of her in the area where we left her. Lots of elephants around. Said to him, I think the elephants have pushed her further to the south. So we went down to the Mawati River, spotted her tracks, and within about 5 meters of seeing her tracks, I was looking on the ground saying, where have her tracks gone? VM says, no, she's lying next to us. And there we go. And then we started following her again, hunting, and we saw her spot something, and she went down into the thickets, and then she just pounced and grabbed a young duiker. And she ate some of it, then hoisted it in the tree, and then she left to go find the cubs. So there's a bit more to the story. So just after she grabbed the duiker, we tried to get in there, and we hit a little stump that bent the steering arm on Rusty. And it happened to be a sort of comedy of errors, because Jandre, who's on camera with me today, was with Jamie, and they were having problems with their radios, cutting out the feed and all sorts of weird things. So they rushed back to swap vehicles. And they went, and you were lucky enough to see Karula moving that dike up into the jackalberry tree where we saw it this morning. However, Vim and I had to call for assistance. Upar came with a hammer and some steel, and managed to straighten this, take the steering arm off, straighten it. The main last bit of straightening we actually did in the V of a Tamburti tree, with the two of us putting our weight on. And we managed to put it back in and carry on driving. And as we drove out and we came around the corner, we found Karula again on her way to fetch the cubs. So it was a very successful evening for us. And of course, a bit of fun bush mechanics as well. Now, a lot of you, when you saw that picture that I put up of the steering arm, thought, wow. Now, you must realize that these steering arms on proper off-road vehicles are designed to actually bend when you hit something a bit hard, because if they didn't bend, you would actually damage a lot more pieces in the car. Your shock absorbers and tie rod ends, all that stuff would break if it bent. So it is actually designed to bend, and fortunately, we are able to bend them back without too much effort. See them there? Bottom left. And there we go. We saw the first one on drive yesterday. This one's calling. Hopefully you call again for us. Come on. No. Here we go, the black cuckoo. So now I'm wondering if we can get some cuckoos on camera this morning. Now, there's quite a rare one that a friend of mine saw yesterday in the Sabi Sands, the thick-billed cuckoo. So we're gonna keep an eye out for him as well. And any other migrants that are arriving. I saw the first European bee eaters of the year last year. Okay.
So far, just from what we've heard, the cuckoos that have arrived, thick-billed cuckoo, black cuckoo, classes cuckoo, red-chested cuckoo, and African cuckoo. So five, and there's probably about 11, which I remember the rest of them. Lavalance, great spotted, Deirdrecks, Jacobin, might be missing one. There we go, there's a sounded like a little bird we don't see too often, don't fly away. Right there. On top of the jumping around there. Top left hand side of the tree. Yeah, there we go, there's hopping around there. Oh, where'd he go? He's hopping around in there. There we go. Oh, it's a southern black tit. And what's with him? Ooh, there's a difficult bird for those of you who are birders. Aha, look at that. Who can identify that one? Oh, and we can hear some weavers somewhere. Oh, he's eating a caterpillar. Now, who can identify that little LBJ, the little brown job? If you can, hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. You can see that wind moving the poor little birdie around. And while we bird, we are being watched. Well, we were being watched, decided our birding wasn't that interesting. The young male in Nyala. How are you? Picking at the monkey orange. Ooh, there's actually a really nice bird party around here. Can you hear them all? A little white-browed scrub of it. I can hear a weaver making a noise. I can't see it yet. The zit 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 is the southern black tit. Let's move forward a little bit. See if we can add a bird to it or two to our party. Apparently my scarf is getting some adoration. Now it's a multi-purpose. I'm just trying to see, I think it could be a red-headed weaver I heard, so I'm trying to look for a spot of red in that knobthorn tree. There's some white helmet strikes in the center. Hopping about. There's a brew shrike there as well. Oh, there he goes. Where's that weaver? I can just hear that. That's the brew shrike there. Oh, this is a bird party. It's the gift that keeps giving. There's quite a few different species in here. Oh, I think that weaver is on the other side. You can just hear it making a noise. There we go. And the yellow-billed hornbill. Well done, Sally in Oregon, says the black cuckoo. 156 species for her. So, if you are new, a lot of our viewers like to keep a bird list. Some people have even got over 200, and Sally's getting there with 156. Let's idle forward, slide forward a little bit. Now, the nice thing about when you're birding like this and you're going very slowly is that if anything does happen to call or get spotted and alarmed at, you're going to hear it because you're moving quietly and slowly through the bush, stopping often. And I think our bird party is over. Oh, no, it's not. A telltale screer of a, there it is. Okay, Jean-André. He's gonna pop out now. He's behind a little bit of wood now, but there, okay. So zoom, a little bit to the left. Okay, keep going, a little bit to the right. Oh, there he is. Looks like a little cardinal woodpecker. That was that. Oh, southern bobo. Okay, zoom, 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 zoom. Down. There we go, there we go. Look at that, the beautiful, beautiful black, white, with that slight sort of rufous underbelly. Now, that, interestingly enough, is the brood parasite species for the black cuckoo. That is the bird the black cuckoo chooses to lay its eggs in. So they will actively look out for southern boo-boos. And southern boo-boos are almost always around these little dry riverbeds. So that's why we often find the black cuckoo also hanging around in the same areas. They're trying to find a boo-boo nest. So nice to see one out in the open. They're normally one of the skulking species that hides in the thickets. Oh, so we've got a first guess in for the bird. Is it a pipit? Unfortunately, it is not a pipit. Now, one must remember about pipits. Pipits are almost exclusively on the ground or on little trees or termite mounds around open areas. So they like short grasses. So it is not a pipit. Jared says, is it a chin spot batis? Unfortunately, it's not, Jared. It's a little bit too big. And remember, a chin spot batis, black and white. That was more of a grey, a little brown job. Okay, let's keep moving. Now, quite a few people said, is it a white-browed scrub robin? It's not. If we go back, look at the, if you got a screenshot of it, look at the shape of the bill. And it's a bit too sort of heavy set for a scrub robin. Now, it is quite a difficult one, especially first off the bat. Oh, Stenborg. Oh, they're disappearing. So we're going to go carefully check to see if Karula has come back or if she has made another kill in this area. This is the area where we left her in last night. While we do that, let's go see what Jamie's up to.
Jamie is in the process of making her way to Cheetah Plains, having done a little bit of a quick fix on our antenna in the front of our vehicle. That's where our final control comms come from. And I'm not entirely sure my fix is going to work. I ripped it out of where it's based a couple of days ago following a lioness through some dense vegetation. And I can't get it back in. So I've just sort of tied it on in the hope that this will be good enough for us to be able to hear questions on cheetah planes. We'll see how we go. Oh, hello. There's a better one in front. Okay. A better one. Aha, there is a better one in that it's closer to us. Female giraffe in ages. Ah, oh, and she doesn't want to be seen at all. Beautiful. Let's go a little bit further forward now that she's behind the trees. She might let us get her. No, not having it. Absolutely not having any of it. It's okay, girl. On a windy day like today, even a giraffe, especially a female, because they're so much smaller than the males, will be incredibly nervous. A pride like the Nkuhumas would absolutely be capable of catching one of these, a giraffe this size. And on a windy day, they probably survive the night feeling terrified. Winds blowing, sounds pitch black because there'd be no moon, cloud cover. Perfect hunting for the predators. And I would not be at all surprised if A, the Nkuhumas are not sitting on Juma with a kill, and B, that Karula might. And that's why this poor little giraffe is a bit nervous. As described, the world's worst wind chime. The remains of Tundi's kill. She was absolutely not coming back to this area or staying in this area after her traumatizing experience with the baboons not too long ago. So she kill scavenging birds hadn't managed to find it. There's our little giraffe. She's now bending over to feed. You'll notice with that head posture, females feed like that more often than the males do. It's one of the ways that supposedly it reduces competition between the males and the females in terms of feeding. You can also see, well, no, you probably can't see, but much, much shorter than the big bulls, the big dark bulls that we've been seeing. Also with the ossicones tufted instead of bald and much, much thinner than that of a male. And you can see as she goes into feed, you can see just how windy it truly is. Brr. All sound and fury and no rain. Nothing quite like a giraffe in terms of elegance. They're very, very pretty creatures. Oh, I think she might even cross in front of us. Oh, no, she's going to stand exactly where we can barely see her. Let's see if we can't try and get a little bit closer. From just a slightly better angle. Hello, girl. I just a massive branch break somewhere, and I actually think it was the wind blowing one of the rotten branches off a marula tree. We've always got to be careful of standing near dead marula trees on a windy day like today. In the meantime, she's giving us a perfect demonstration of her purple tongue. And Ninas, you're wondering, while we look at this female giraffe, we saw one earlier, and now she's a little bit away from her. You're wondering if a giraffe are usually on their own, unless they have... Oh! She got some up her nose there. Unless they have babies. Giraffe are interesting creatures in that they don't... Oh, look, here comes one at the back. Ah, very interesting. Nice comparison here as to why you shouldn't necessarily base age or sex off colour for a giraffe. Sorry, Ninas, I'll get back to you in a second. Because this is also a female, but much, much darker in colour. Now, they do tend to darken with age, and the males tend to be darker than the females, but you've got to be very careful, because just like human beings, there are different genetic variants. There you can see the colour contrast between the two. And then we actually have the answer to Nina's question, which is whether or not they are solitary. So giraffes are curious. They are quite happy to be on their own, particularly the big bulls, but they are quite happy to move about on their own, and then sometimes they come together, form herds. They're not territorial at all. The only time they will ever fight is when two males are fighting over a female in estrus. So they have what's known as a social aggregation. And they don't have a set herd structure. Eland are the same in certain areas. It will be dependent on the area that you're in. And sometimes we see journeys of giraffe, for that is the correct collective noun, like a pride of lions, a journey of giraffe, of up to 7 or 8 members at a time, sometimes even more, depending upon where you happen to be. It's always a pleasure to see lots of them together. So there's no set herd structure. It's not like a pride of lions that will stay together for its entire life. Hello, girl. Hey, look, I can finally make my Monday morning traffic joke. Now, Justin, while we're looking at the massive creature that is a giraffe, and the longer you look at them, the weirder they start to look, Justin wants to know if a giraffe gives birth standing up. And yes, they do. Which means that a baby giraffe's first experience of the outside world is a 2-meter drop. You might find 1 or 2 females that have given birth lying down, but they do stand up. There's a story that that drop is actually necessary for a baby giraffe to start its struggle to get out of the amniotic sac. I don't believe that. I think that that would happen regardless. But elephants and giraffe, both of them do not lie down to give birth. So both of their babies have a very difficult entrance into the world. Now, speaking about baby giraffe, interestingly enough, I'm hoping we're going to see some at some point relatively soon, although definitely from not from this female. She doesn't look pregnant to me. Interesting thing about, and what makes giraffe different from antelope, you see the ossicones on the top of her head. An antelope, they are born without horns, and those horns start to develop when they're a couple of months old and poke through the skin, made of solid bone. In giraffe babies are actually born with those ossicones, but they lie flat against the head, the back of the head, so that when they're born it doesn't cause any kind of obstruction, and they are soft and almost made of cartilage, let's just go with that, and floppy. And then as they start to develop, within a couple of days, those ossicones pop upright and stand up, and then the bone slowly starts to deposit and stays there permanently, which is why they are not called horns. They are called ossicones. That's a stunning image. Rising sun, giraffe walking down the road. And off she goes. The other magical thing, of course, about giraffe babies is that they are disproportionate, which sounds weird when you consider the adults who are, I suppose you could also consider them rather disproportionate as well. And just by the way, look how much she's feeding with her head down when you compare it to the bulls that we see. What I mean when I say the babies are disproportionate, well, they have to be able to keep up with mum's long stride, because even though she looks like she's walking slowly, she's already covered quite the distance between us and herself. Now, babies have to be able to keep up with their mothers, but at the same time they have to be able to get their heads under her to suckle. Marilee in Illinois. You're saying when a giraffe eats leaves from a branch, is it considered, as she's doing for us perfectly right now with that purple tongue, is it considered to be a grazer or a browser? It is a browser, and it was pretty much a strict browser. In other words, it doesn't really supplement its food with anything else. It is purely a leaf-based diet. That being said, that's what all the textbooks say. I have seen giraffe eat grass. It's a very, very strange image. I thought the giraffe was bending down to drink at a puddle. Oh! And now? Full of the joys this morning. That was such a random hop, skip and jump. Here we go, to the viewer that asked about whether or not our animals are asleep this morning. Nope. Wide awake. Wide awake and positively skipping with joy. You'll probably find actually a fly or something bit her on the ankle or the inside of the leg and she just flicked it away. How terribly entertaining she has been. So there are browsers, strict browsers like things like kudu, and as opposed to things like buffalo.
Oh, and look at this. Jandre is fixing a virtual reality rig. Ha ha ha. Look at him. He's starting to blush already. Isn't he cute? Oh, poor Jandre. Look, cameramen don't really like the camera. Look, he's got no choice. I love it. Sorry, Tax is just getting hold of me. Wait, move the branch so we can go through. Sorry, Taxi. It's at Nyala Road South Junction with a Mulwati in that big Ntoma tree there. Okay, let's carry on. We found another new road. But it's not actually a new road. It's a fire break that's been reopened. So, oh dear, it hasn't been reopened all the way. It stops. So also the one reason I chose to come up here is that we're the only car driving on it, so that means much easier to see any tracks. But so far no sign of Queen Karula. Let's go back to the main road. Wow. A little bit earlier we were looking at a little LBJ. A little brown job, which is a birding term for a small, indescript, generally brown or greyish little bird. And well done to James, Richard and Rebecca, who got it spot on. I will show you now what it was. There we go. Now, it was a yellow-throated Petronia, a type of sparrow. Now, you can see that little yellow spot. We don't have them with the yellow spot. I mean, here's another picture. There we go. That's our race we get here. So some of the yellow-throated Petronias don't have a yellow spot on their throat. But those big white sort of earmuffs are a very distinctive thing. Also shape of the beak. But there we go. Well done to you guys. It's not an easy bird. Look at that. Onward. Whoopsie. Not if I stall. There we go, onward. Onward in search of Queen Karula. Oh, hang on a second. Standing by. Taxi, we saw a Bamba Munti last night and she put it up in the Ntoma tree, but we left her at 6:30 around the Weaver's Nest heading south to fetch Mampimpans. I'm just seeing if she's come back. Okay, copy. Yeah, there was Nkonzo all over quarantine last night. Some was heading back down to the Mwati, other was heading a bit more west. Sorry about that, Tax, and just finding out where we saw the lion tracks around quarantine. We did have a quick then. There we go. Oh, thank you, Jandre. Thank you. Jacob in Virginia is wondering, have I ever seen a leopard leap from a tree to make a kill? Once. In Botswana. But it is less common. Okay. I wonder where she's gone. Maybe she's caught something in here, so we'll have a little loop down towards Treehouse Waterhole. This is one of her favorite entrance and exit points on Juma. This is where we had that incredible sighting a week or so ago of her playing with the two little darlings, Xongile and Hosana. Yesterday, it pretended to be summer in the morning. Now it's gone again so quickly. The weather has been quite strange for October. Is it October is often called suicide month in southern and central Africa, and because the mercury regularly goes over 40 degrees. I don't think we've come close to 40 degrees this October yet. 40 degrees Celsius, of course. 40 degrees Fahrenheit would be bitterly unpleasant. I think it's time to listen a little bit, but while we do that, Shelley in Arizona would like to know about leopard territories. Now, I think the best way to show you, I'll take my blanket off, is to draw you a little map. And specifically about male leopard territories, where they are and whatnot. Now I need a pen or a stick. Okay. How's this over here, Jandre? Can you see my line? Yeah, there you go. Let's just call back to the western boundary of the Sabi Sands. And okay. Very basic. Right, can we see it so far, Jandre? And there we go. And more or less something like that. Okay. Let's just make this a bit smaller, just so we can see. Okay, here we go. Okay, Juma is here. That's Torchwood. This is lots of different things. Hoffmans, little gauri, Annettes, chitwa chitwa. I hear elephants somewhere. This is Arethusa. That is Sibambili. This is Elephant Plains. That's Ottawa. Okay, so I'm first asking about Gajima's territory. Gajima's territory, this is Buffalo's Hook here. Gajima's territory, so here's Juma. Pretty much, from my understanding, just does this. We don't know really where it goes down here. Now, Imvula has been sort of hiding in this little corner here over the last while, just on the edge of his territory. Now, Tingana has got a massive territory, pretty much like that. So that's Gajima, Tingana. Now, you were asking about Anderson, the male. He comes to the Marikane River in Arethusa, and then literally he goes all the way down to Londolozi, into the Sand River down here, and he comes all the way around to Ottawa, and he comes back all the way for most of Sibambili till he hits, all the way here. Whoa, big territory. So he gets seen all over there. Now, you will get a little bit of overlap each way with these males, depending on who's around at the moment. But I think that's the easiest way to show you territories for now. I'm gonna have to draw a proper map of one of these days, and I'll pop it on the social media. Oh, back under the blankie, that's quite nice, warm. I was hoping we were going to hear some alarm calls while we were drawing away there, but alas. Hello, Marjorie. Marjorie's wondering, why was Karula's cubs not with her? She thought at this age they'd be hunting alongside her. Leopards don't do that, Marjorie. Even when those cubs are a year old, she'll try to leave them somewhere while she hunts. And quite often all that the cubs will do is ruin the hunt. Now, they hone their hunting skills in those times that they're left alone chasing lizards and birds and all sorts of things. What is it? Oh, you're just testing. Oh, switch it off. Sorry, I just heard beep, 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 beep. John were playing with buttons and the GoPros. But, so Marjorie, leopards don't need to learn how to hunt, neither do lions. This is a very big misconception that people have. Those hunting skills are instinctive. They are born with them. All you have to do is let them get hungry and he'll learn how to hunt. And a perfect example of this is young Xongile, who learned how to hunt very quickly as soon as he got a little bit hungry. So we just had a nice drawing of all those leopard territories. And Nino would like to know, how often do those males fight? Very seldom. Now, it's only really when you can just hear that beautiful call. Nino, I haven't forgotten about you. Can you just hear it? Where is he, Xongile? Let's try. It's right in the little bit of the thicket here. I'm sure we're going to spot it shortly. Let's try it this way. It's amazing how you can hear that bird so clearly, yet we can't see it. Can you see it, Chandra? Maybe a bit further back. Let's try. Can you hear that? Such a, that looks, it sounds like it's right in the center. That thicket. Beautiful call though of the white-browed scrub robin. They being a proper skulker. Ooh, 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 ooh. Thought I heard an impala snort in the distance. Okay, we'll carry on. Sorry, Nina. They very seldom actually come to blows. Only when there's sort of a new male, coming into the area. Or a young male coming into the area, they'll see him off. Or in case with Mvula, an old male who's being pushed. Sorry, I'm just listening. Thought someone had found a Karula crossing. Oh, we just want to have one last look here, because you never know. She could have quite easily caught something right here. So, hi, Joan in Washington. Sorry, that Game Drive Radio is very busy at the moment. Joan is wondering, how does a female leopard let its female cub know which territory it's giving them? Well, by leaving it there, Joan, and she'll find that there's no other scent marks of other female leopards in that area. Now, it doesn't always work. If there's a high density of leopards, sometimes the females are pushed out, but normally they will sequester a section of their territory off to their female cub to give her an easier start in life. This is the last spot we saw Karula last night. Just checking in the trees. Nothing there. So, well, let's go see how Jamie's doing down in the deep east.
We've finally made it onto Cheetah Plains. Let us go and find out whether or not Quarantine is still around with his kudu kill. Now, Andrew's already out and about. He says he's going to go and investigate and let us know. But in the meantime, I'm following Andrew's tire tracks because I don't know exactly where this kill is. I'm just working on the assumption that these are his tracks. I know the rough area, and we'll figure it out as we go along. I hear that you've been doing birds with Brent and all the different types of cuckoos as well, I think he was talking about. I have to tell you that Brent and I had quite a serious disagreement last night on the subject of cuckoos and whether or not we'd heard a classes cuckoo or a thick-billed cuckoo, which sound remarkably similar. And the end result of that was we probably were both listening to different birds and we were probably both right, but it was a matter for serious disagreement before bed, arguing over the nuances of the cuckoo calls. I'm hoping this antenna fix is going to... Well, let's see. We'll work it out as we go along. It seems to be entirely directionally based. So if I get it pointing in the right direction, I should be able to hear your questions. Ah, dear. Not yet. Let's get out of the dip, and then we'll see if I can try that question once again. Perhaps it'll work, perhaps it won't. Oh, we've dealt with worse problems before. Michael, I think your question, I think I've got a bit of it. It's definitely Michael. And I think the question is, what is the biggest prey that a leopard can take down, if I'm not mistaken? Here we go. Yes. Got it right. So, Michael, it depends on if, obviously it depends on if we're talking about a male or a female, since the males are so much larger than the females. The females, probably the biggest thing they can take down is a kudu, a slightly smallish kudu, not a big adult male kudu. For the males, there's stories of large male leopards taking down baby giraffe and baby buffalo. Now, that is within the realms of possibility. Sure, it's cold. There's even stories of Anderson hoisting baby giraffe up into trees. Now, that's prey that is well over 100 kilograms, so well over 200 pounds. The fact that they can do that is absolutely phenomenal. It really, truly is mind-boggling, the power of these animals. But that is probably the maximum. A leopard would not be capable of taking down buffalo or a large adult buffalo or an adult giraffe. Standing by, Andrew. Sorry, I have to shelter down here.
Yeah, I'm sitting around with my daughter. So it's from here in the road, come south with Malamalaban.
Copy that, thank you. I'm at 3 in a row pan now. I'll see you shortly. Yes! You're still around. It'll all be worth it in the end. The struggle with the comms and the windy day. Let's go and have a look at Quarantine. My second time seeing him. Let's go see the size of his kudu kill. Sharon, you've asked a question about Quarantine. I'm not 100% sure. Aha! Where is Quarantine's territory? There we go. That's an interesting thing about Quarantine, is he's just in the process of establishing a territory. Though it seems... Whew, I think this might actually... try and tuck my microphone under my hat as well. Hide it from the wind. His territory, he's in the process of establishing it. He's still quite a young male, and he's been tolerated by his older brother Shimambalana for a considerable period of time. He moves between Torchwood and Coral and Cheetah Plains, and I think probably a little bit into the Kruger National Park as well. It's difficult to know exactly, but mainly Torchwood, mainly sort of the eastern side of the northern Sabi Sands. Now, that being said, would I call it a territory just yet? Because that's basically Shimbambalana's territory, who is much older and, although not much bigger than Quarantine. Quarantine's a big boy. I'm not sure we'd call it a territory just yet. I think he's still a little bit young for us to go down that route. I think it's probably more like a home range that he's found. He's found a male that'll tolerate him. He's been known to share kills with Mvula in the past, who is a possible father. I'm not sure. I'm open to opinions as to whether or not we'd call it a territory. Young female leopards will establish a territory much earlier than the males. The males, right up until the age of about 6 or so, they'll be wandering about, attempting to find a vacuum before they're big enough to truly compete with a male leopard. And I think that's why Shimbambalana, for the moment, although they still scrap every now and again, I think that's why he tolerates the presence of his younger brother. Hello. It's my favorite bird on Cheetah Plains. There's so many of them. We might even get lucky and see the wind blow the helmet of this bird up so we can see the red crest. Ah, no. You can see it's started looking up, lifting up. We had such an amazing sighting with the red-crested Korhan a couple of days ago, with it calling away. There's about 3 males that live in this area, and they're constantly calling to each other. And one day my patience and persistence will pay off, and we'll actually... Oh, he might call in response. Can hear a male calling elsewhere. I don't really want to lift up the volume of the microphone too much, though, or we don't, because otherwise you are going to be blasted by the sound of the wind. Let's go to quarantine before everybody starts to arrive and we have to leave. Let's go make the most of our time with him. He's somewhere in this general direction. Sorry, Kirst. With the best of intentions, there's absolutely no way I can hear. But hold on, let's get to quarantine. And we can try and see if I can change the angle of the vehicle so that the antenna gets it. Did you get any of that, Viam? Nope. Oh dear. Most distressing. I did try. I really tried to fix it properly so that we, well, fix it as well as I can. It's amazing what gaffer tape and bungee cords can do. I think that was link across to Brent. I think that was what the case while we go and find quarantine. And I'll try and reposition so that we can hear our radio comms slightly more clearly. Was I right, Kirst? Is that what I meant to do? Oh dear. Are we live? Are we not live?
Welcome. Sorry about the giggling from Jean-Jean and myself. We just got from Kirsten. You are off air, but we are definitely not. We are live. So we're continuing our search for the Queen of Juma on another one of the new, well, not new, but recently opened again firebreak roads. Isn't it lovely? It feels like we're in a new place driving down them. And much nicer than driving down Gowrie Main. I know Jean-Day will be very happy. There's no corrugations on this road, so Jean-Day is nodding his head profusely. Cameras don't like corrugations. So we're heading down towards Twin Dams Road and the Mawashi River. Honey badger tracks. Now, we've been discussing leopard territories and John in Boston. Ooh, John, I'll get your question in a second. Oh, don't disappear. He's disappearing. There's a big male kudu. I think forward's going to be better for you, Jean-Dre. How's that? He's going to disappear. Yeah, look at that. Massive horns. Yes, you. Watch as he moves through the thick bush. If he gets to a low branch, watch how he puts those horns back. Almost touching his back to duck under things. Very impressive kudu ball. Who's disappearing? And is gone! Sorry, John. Now, John would like to know whether male and female leopards can share territory. Most definitely so. Their territories work separately. The females will defend their territory from other females, and the males will defend their territory from other males. And a male leopard territory, let's take Tingana, for example, will hold multiple females. So within Tingana's territory, he's got Karula, Shadow, Salahesh, Tandi, trying to think, there's another, I can't remember her name, but there's some others down south on near the Marla boundary that also fall within his territory that we don't know so well. I'm just trying to avoid the VR rig and a branch, so it means I have to sit in the branches. Jandre, you and your VR rig, look what it makes happen to me. Oh no, earpiece, come back. Oh, there we go, now it's got it, it's got my earpiece. Thank you. This is, of course, Jandre's fault. I blame him for everything. Okay, I'm back. So often a male leopard territory will encompass 4 or 5 different females' territory. Of course, that gives him the best chance of spreading his genetic line by being able to mate with those different males. Now, females will actually move up to 2 or 3 territories out of their own territory to mate with males, so that any male that comes across their cubs will think that they might, or there's a possibility they might be the father, because if she hasn't mated with a male and he comes into that territory, he will kill the cubs, sometimes eat them. Now, the biggest danger to leopard cubs is actually other male leopards, and in this area about 70% of all the mortalities are caused by nomadic male leopards. So the likes of Xongile, Quarantine, Kunyuma, those guys are the biggest killers of other leopard cubs. So we're going to slowly make our way back to the tree climbing diker in case Karula has snuck through and we have missed her. If unfortunately she isn't there, I think we'll go give Taxon a hand looking for the Inkahumas. Now, I know Jamie is very excited, and this is only the second time I think she's managed to spend time with one of, I think, everyone's favorite leopards. So let's go have a look.
Isn't he absolutely gorgeous? Oh, that was very graceful, Mr. Q. Got a little bit of a limp, but I cannot get over how massive he is getting as he makes his way towards his kudu kill. It is an adult male kudu, so there's plenty of meat on it. It is slightly smelly, but well done to Quarantine. And joys is that the position of our vehicle, we can actually hear your questions and the things happening that Kirst wants to tell us, which is even better. Wonderful. These are the magic moments of Cheetah Plains. To get to see this young male leopard truly actually coming into his prime now. And I don't take back what I said earlier about the territorial question, but he's definitely getting big enough to start competing soon. And I think there may well be some serious skirmishes between him and Shimbambalane in the future. Tucking into his kudu kill. I think, I don't know, I mean, it's a discussion that's open for debate, but I will say that I think that young male leopards are probably the most beautiful. Yeah, it's difficult to compare, of course. There's something so beautifully symmetrical about them. Oh, Oh, yay. Second time seeing Quarantine. I'm sure VM has seen him countless times. Really? This was the very first leopard that VM ever saw.
On this job.
Yes, doing this job, to clarify. So the very first leopard that VM ever saw live. I'm trying to think which one was mine. I think it was Shadow and Xongile, actually. It took me a long time before I saw Karula. He's definitely a firm favourite. For our new viewers who are joining us for the first time, this might be your first time seeing Quarantine as well. He is the daughter of Queen Karula, who made that date. No, he's not the daughter. That's entirely not right. He is the son of Queen Karula, who made that Dacre kill yesterday afternoon on the Sunset Safari. And he is slowly getting to the point where he is almost... Well, he's really starting to come into his prime. So he's about... How old is he? He's four. Three and a half. 2012. Yeah, he would be about four now. Please, for those of you who have been watching for many, many years, just clarify exactly how old he is. I think he's four. He looks about 4 years old, although he is massive. He also has a brother called Kunuma, who is Brent's favourite leopard, one of Brent's favourite leopards. Apparently has a tremendous personality. Highly entertaining, doing all kinds of interesting things, like climbing onto the edge of rotting trees and smacking buffalo on the bottom and then running away. Young male leopards are always thoroughly entertaining. I arrived just after Kunuma and Quarantine dispersed away from their mother's territory. They were spending a huge amount of time on Juma, and as far as I know, that's where the name Quarantine comes from. That is why he's called Quarantine, because he spent so much time around a quarantine clearing. So there you go, David in Napa. Although perhaps the name Quarantine might have been more appropriate for Xongile, in hindsight, with him having to be rushed off and put in quarantine after the incident with the rabid dog. I think that Quarantine is, as far as I know, Quarantine is named for the clearings. Is he spent a lot of time around quarantine clearings. Is that right, Liam? Yeah, makes total sense. Oh, there we go. That is where David in Napa, that is where the name Quarantine comes from. Quarantine clearings was named Quarantine clearings because it's where cattle were quarantined. Or wildebeest, depending on who you ask. I've got two different answers out of two different sources. I'm too scared to reposition, I'm afraid. I would really like to, but I'm too scared to in case I can't hear Kirsty again. At the moment, I can hear her perfectly. So for now, we'll settle with the view that we have. And thank you to Siberia Zumi, and I'm sure many others who will also be sending through the clarification. He is indeed roughly 4 years old. He actually looks older, you know. He's a massive boy. And I think he's got quite a distinctive personality from what I understand. Now, Ninas, you are looking at this kill and you wanted to know what it is and if it is bigger than his mum's. It is much, much bigger than his mum's. It is an adult male kudu, or at least a teenage male kudu. You can just see the start of the curve of the horns there. And he's obviously been snacking on this for at least the last day or so. But it's absolutely massive. So the dacre that Karula caught was probably... We were trying to work out exactly how much it would weigh. We sort of came to the conclusion it would be just under 20-odd kilograms or so. An adult male kudu, on the other hand, is much, much larger. Over 100 kilograms. Although this is... I'm not sure exactly how old this one was. But it is a kudu with quite large horns, so he's done an amazing job. Now, Susan, judging by the smell, this kill has been around for at least 2 days. It is quite smelly if you end up on the wrong side of it. Luckily, we're on the right side of it at the moment. I can't see from where we are now, and I wasn't able to see when we came in, just how much he's eaten. It might have been from not last night, but the night before, if I had to guess roughly. Obviously, it took a little while for people to find him. But yes, I think it was from 2 evenings ago, roughly. He was only found yesterday afternoon, or at the end of yesterday morning, the end of game drive then. And of course, we never managed to get there yesterday afternoon after things went so disastrously wrong. Oh no, wind, don't change. Don't do that to us. We found such a prime position. Now, when you saw him scratching his claws up against the silver cluster leaf, you would have noticed he is very full-bellied. So he's been quite happily feeding. Now, this massive kudu carcass is in a place where there's hardly any appropriate hoisting trees. The only one that I can see is far away, the marula tree in the distance. I can't see anything else here that he would have had to have dragged it very, very far to get it to a good hoisting tree. So he's fortunate in that here on Cheetah Plains, there's actually not that much hyena activity, not compared to Juma, say, or around Elephant Plains or Arethusa. There's obviously hyena here, but they tend, I think this must be the outskirts of a clan territory. Perhaps if he'd been a little bit further to the east, he'd have more of a chance of losing it. But remember how Shimbambalana was feeding off that buffalo carcass for 2 days to bursting point, right on the boundary with Kruger, and he had no competition from hyenas. Now this makes it makes Cheetah Plains a really good spot for leopards. They don't have to worry too much about losing their kills. If this had been on Juma, he would have lost it last night to the hyenas. But it's not, it's Cheetah Plains. Now it's either Mick or Nick, but I think we're doing quite well here. Nick Mick 1011, you wanted to know whether or not a leopard could get sick from eating rotten meat, which is of course what he's doing at the moment. No. The answer is very, very seldom. So the digestive systems of all of our predators are incredibly resilient. Their stomach acid is exceptionally powerful, although it is particularly with hyenas that that is the case. They're capable of essentially dissolving bone. But their digestive systems are built to cope with rotten meat. They're exposed to it from a very, very young age, and they've got all kinds of immunity to the various bacteria. That being said, it is very common to come upon diarrhea from predators or vomit as well, although a lot of the time the vomit is caused by, or the vomiting is caused by the animal eating too quickly, consuming either too much fur or a shard of bone or hoof that they actually can't digest properly, and then they just have to bring it up again. It's very common to see them sitting and eating off grass. It's amazing how much better at it these animals are than we are in terms of coping with disease, injury, infection. They're very, very powerful immune systems. That being said, if you ever find yourself, I don't know in what kind of position you might be, if you ever find yourself in a hands-on position with an anaesthetized predator, important to remember you should probably be wearing gloves when you're exposing yourself to their saliva or anything to do with them. They carry an enormous number of internal parasites. You'll often find tapeworm in their scat and in their vomit. So their digestive systems are particularly unpleasant, and their saliva is very dangerous. You can actually get serious, serious infections from it. You know, I mean, human saliva is the same. A human bite can be worse than that of a dog, if, you know, in those situations. But it's important to be very careful of predators. It's one of the big reasons why we don't ever touch predator scat with our bare hands. We do collect predator scat to give to Panthera, which is something that we will be doing once quarantine moves away from this kill. Obviously, I don't think he'd be terribly impressed with me if I got out right now. He's clearly enjoying his kudu breakfast. See him grappling with it. Those paws are still, he still looks like he's growing into his paws to me. He's going to be huge. Enormous boy. I know this isn't a great position right now, but he is going to tire of feeding soon. And then we'll be able to, he'll probably come straight back to where he was lying and settle back down again. Look at the size of his feet. You see that dew claw hooking into the skin, holding the kill in place while he pulls and tears at the flesh. It's actually not an easy job eating raw meat. Predators have to work quite hard to move the meat from the bones. that is wonderful news. What an extraordinary morning. We've got one leopard here all the way on Cheetah Plains on a kill. Let's go and have a look at another.
So quickly, quickly, that side. Look at that, we've found Karula and both the cubs. Karula has made another kill. So after she killed that duiker last night, she's killed an adult male impala. There's young Hosana on the kill. And little Xongile was actually stalking us, and that's what we started on. Then Hosana made his way towards his mom. Isn't this amazing? Aren't we absolutely lucky? Karula's got two kills. It means she's going to be with us for a little while. What it looks like from the tracks that we found, she went to fetch the cubs, and on her way back, she must have spotted this impala, and it was ideal hunting weather for her last night. Strong, windy conditions, dark skies, and she managed to catch this adult male impala. Now Sean's wondering, are there visual differences between male and female leopards that can be seen from a distance? Indeed they are, Sean, and it's mostly size. Also, a big male leopard will have a dewlap, sort of loose skin hanging around his neck. And there we go, and little Hosana is playing more than feeding with the kill. Let me just try and move forward for you a little bit there, Jean-André. Ooh, that's not good. Bendix is getting stuck. How's that? I think we can get a little bit further. How's that? Do they get a gap through? Practice. Got an ear. Got an eye. Got an ear. Got a nose. Like a game you play with a little child. I got your ear. Having too much fun. Now we saw young Xongile play with a duiker carcass not so long ago. So as you can see, a lot of those instincts are there. So it's those habits are instinctual. They know, he knows what to do, even though he's a little guy. Has he got stuck in a thorn tree? Bite that Sisyphus. How are you going to get out of this one now? He got stuck on his tail, so now he's bitten it. Oh, there we go. He's got rid of it now. Is he still fighting with a stick, or is he fighting with some fluff he managed to grab this time? Fluff. And a stick. He's trying to get that thorny stick away from his playground. Now, I couldn't think of anything worse than putting a buffalo thorn in my mouth. It gives you an idea how tough these creatures are. He's getting angry with it. Keeps hooking him. Well, that'll be a lesson. don't bite buffalo thorns. So he might actually have a thorn in his mouth that he's trying to get rid of. When his tongue... Was it in his paw? I can't really see from here. Yeah, back to playing. Ray is wondering how we can tell these leopards apart. Well, Ray, fortunately, we spend a lot of time with them. Now, with the two cubs, Hosana is the bigger of the cubs, and that's him. He's the little male. And when he turns around, you can see his face is quite different from his sister's. Not only his spot pattern, but just his general, his face in general. His sister's also got quite lovely brown eyes, darker eyes than he does. But at a quick glance, you can tell the difference between the two cubs from their size. Karula, she's just very distinct. I mean, she is the leopard we see the most, although she is lying with her back to us. And little Xongile is sleeping right next to us on the right. I mean, it's just, we're going to stick with the leopards at the kill now, see if Hosana starts doing something fun again. Now, isn't this amazing? We're going to jump from one leopard here on Juma, or actually from three leopards here on Juma, to one on Cheetah Plains.
How incredibly lucky are we? What a lovely morning to have to choose between Karula and her cubs and the gorgeous Quarantine. And he is a seriously handsome boy. Just look at that face. You can see he's starting to develop his dewlap as well. The sort of loose skin at the base of a male leopard's neck that serves a very important protective function if they ever do come into confrontation with each other. And those massive muscles that join the head to the shoulders. He's starting to look like a seriously powerful male. Hello, gorgeous. And his beautiful eye makeup. These males are definitely pretty boys. Now, looking at his back, Vim was just telling me about the scar, the massive injury that he had on his back. I can see the scar now. I can see there's a slight indentation in his back from where he had some kind of scrap with somebody. When was it, Vim?
About a year ago.
This time about a year ago. I wonder what it was that he encountered. Either way, he's had a lucky escape, because that's quite a vulnerable spot on any animal. Any bite near the spine can be exceptionally dangerous, because apart from the possibility of the initial injury, severing something around the spinal cord, the chances of infection, if they do go into the bone itself, are very, very dangerous. Ah, where are we off to? Are we going on an adventure, boy? I wonder if he's just on the lookout for more shade, or if he's going to go and have a drink at Three in a Row Pan. Let's just wait for a moment before we reposition, just because I have to pick my spots carefully. Ha, excuse the pun. So does Kirsty. I have to pick my positioning of the vehicle carefully, so that we make sure that we've got communication with the outside world, and so that we can hear your questions coming through. That's a stunning view. Kelvin, sorry, I've got part of your question, which is, are the leopards in danger? I think you said because of their skin. Am I correct there? Okay, their fur, their pelt. I see. Kelvin, yes, to an extent that is one of the risks that leopards do face, unfortunately, in this world. Luckily, in the Sabi Sand, the leopards are absolutely 100% safe and protected in that particular sense. But there are traditional, first of all, people who would like to use leopards for their fur. And then there's actually a serious tradition in a lot of the local cultures of wearing a leopard pelt. Where'd he go? Oh, there. He's calling under a bush willow. You strange cat. Huh. What an odd spot to pick. Okay, fair enough. I guess it makes sense. It's nice and sheltered. He's hot and it's windy, so he's found a nice spot to settle. Oh, Calvin, yes, there are traditional uses as well of using a leopard pelt. In certain cultures, it is a sign of becoming a man to wear a leopard pelt. So yes, they do get killed for it in other parts of South Africa, which is an absolute tragedy and a travesty. And there are lots and lots of organizations out there geared towards educating people about the magic of these creatures and actually trying to create artificial or faux fur, artificial pelts, to prevent leopards being poached and killed for their skins. And that is across the board in Africa. We're very lucky in that we don't have that problem here. The other major problem, of course, in terms of leopards and threats to leopards, because it's difficult to track down and hunt a leopard, but when they are on farms, and there are lots and lots of rural farms in South Africa, they're seen as a tremendous threat to the livestock, and farmers often go out of their way to get rid of them in whatever way they can possibly think of. But again, there are tremendous education programs. South Africa's got some of the strongest environmental protection laws in the world. And there are lots and lots of organizations out there that are fighting to educate people and protect these incredible cats. He's found the perfect snoozing spot. Sure, you'd never know he was there. If we didn't know about this kudu kill, and we just happened to be driving along, he would be the easiest thing in the world to miss. At that angle that he's in, it makes you wonder how many leopards we've driven past. Although it's something I don't actually really want to think about. He's completely hidden. He's less than, I'd say he's about 40 meters from the road. And we would have had no idea he was there. He would have just watched us drive past. Oh, well. Quarantine snoozes off his heavy belly. His younger brother is currently filling his.
Indeed he is. Little Hosana is getting stuck into the ribcage of that adult male impala. You can see those claws extended out as he grips the side of that impala to give himself some leverage. You can see he's right inside there. All the main good juicy bits, the liver, the lungs, the heart have probably been eaten already. And a bit of the rump as well. And so now that they've got the good bits, it's time to start working on the rest. Hi, Greg in Oklahoma is wondering, when a leopard is born, does it have all its spots or do they develop as it gets older? No, they're born with all their spots and they just look a little bit tighter together and they're a little bit darker. Now that's so they can hide when they're very young because the mother has to leave them to hunt. Now mom's looking very relaxed at the moment. And I can't see, can you see little naughty Xongile from where you are, Jandre? Binoculars there. She was snoozing quite nicely behind a little stump. And Karula is such a fantastic mother and an incredible huntress. And that's two kills in one night. And Karula's family is going to be eating well for the next couple of days. Although those little guys are growing so fast and eating so much, that diker probably definitely wouldn't have been enough for them. What is Karula? Oh no, look, she's gonna come feed as well. Oh, she might be looking. Here we go, to try cover some of the stomach contents, or even the blood, to try make sure the scent doesn't waft and attract hyenas. Lauren in Illinois is wondering whether the male cub would try and mate with his mother or sister. Not at this age, and I mean, it's always a possibility, but normally by the time the male leopard's going to come into sexual maturity, he's probably going to be quite far away from his natal range. And now lions, it happens a lot more often. Leopards less so, but it is possible that he might try. It's just unlikely. Some juicy bits there. Now they'll be very careful while they're feeding not to open the stomach contents too much, because that smell will permeate through the air and attract possible other predators. So it looks like he's after some of the soft organs. It could be kidneys and whatnot left. He also will drink the blood that is pooling inside the rib cage. That's what it looks like he might be doing to a degree now, both eating some of the soft tissue and drinking some of the blood. Now, leopards will drink when they have the option to, but they're by no means reliant on water. They have the most incredible array of habitats that they can survive in. But they seem to do best in the mixed grassland and woodland like we have here in the low folds of South Africa. And some of the biggest male leopards in the world from this part of the world, from this area. Well, hello, Mix 1011. Who only found us yesterday. Great to have you back with us again. And Max 1011 says, I only found the stream yesterday. It's been amazing both times. Well, it has. We've been very lucky, though, with the Queen being very forthcoming in showing us. But now I'm so happy to have her cubs back. Now she's made 2 kills, but an adult and male impala and a diker in a tree, probably about 400 meters from here. I hope you guys are getting some good screenshots. Now, James Richards wondering is, will Karula fetch that diker and bring it here? Or will she leave it where it's already hoisted? She'll leave it where it's hoisted. Now, hopefully she hoists this kill as well. It's a bit heavy for her now, an adult male impala, so they still need to eat quite a bit more of it before she's going to be able to hoist this. And there's always the risk when these kills are on the ground that it could be stolen by hyena or lion. Or male leopard will also steal the kill from her. And he might share it, just depends. Now get ready, I'm waiting for him to look up at me with that wearing lipstick. I haven't got the right shot yet. I'm hoping little Xongile is going to make her way to join the feast at some point. Okay, well, we're going to sit here. Hopefully little Xongile is going to come out shortly. And while we do that, let's go back to Jamie and quarantine.
Quarantine appears to have found his place for the day. It's a perfectly sheltered spot where he is sleeping away quite happily. And this is the only view that we can get of him. It's the best possible view that we have. What we'll probably do is, once we're done here, we'll probably leave and start making our way back to Juma, where we can hear things again. But for now, we'll stick around a little bit longer and watch as this beautiful cat snoozes away. Nina's talking about family relations out here, and of course we've got a nice little dynamic going on with Brent, with Quarantine's mother and his two younger siblings. You'd like to know what would happen if Quarantine and Karula were to meet. It's always a complex question with leopards, and they never do what you expect them to do. As a young male, he is an automatic threat to her cubs, and she would probably behave as such. If she were on her own, that would be a different story. She might even tolerate him quite happily. And if she were an estrus, as is with all leopards, if she were an estrus and he were dominant, showing signs of dominance, she might even mate with him. Leopards and lions are not concerned with the same moral implications that human beings are. But generally that isn't what happens. For the most part, they would meet up peacefully. If she didn't have cubs with her, they'd meet up peacefully. They could even share kills. I'm certain in my own mind that she would recognize him as her son. That being said, if her cubs were there, it would be a whole different ball game. She would probably growl and block him and try and distract him in the same way we saw Shadow do with Xongile, not be friendly to him at all, and try and lead him away, and her cubs would disappear off into the vegetation. That being said, again, leopards do strange things. It's not unheard of to have multiple generations sharing a kill quite peacefully and quite happily. And Quarantine's at that curious age. He's at that in-between bit. Not quite fully dominant yet. Not quite having established a territory, starting to call and spray and mark his territory. And at the same time, he is just big enough. He's on that cusp where it could go either way. So it's impossible to say for sure. And also, I think, personally, I think it probably depends upon the personality of the cats as well, as to how they respond to each other. Quarantine has often been seen sharing kills with Mvula, and often seen calling to Mvula and acknowledging his presence. Viam was telling me that story. It was a Quarantine, Viam?
And Mvula.
Yes, Quarantine and Mvula, where Quarantine happened to stumble upon Mvula and started calling to him. A sort of familiar friend, almost. You never know what to expect. Leopards do strange things. Like the information that Ellen sent through about Shadow and Karula seen around the same kill site. Yet for the most part, Shadow and Karula don't appreciate being in each other's company. Who knows how leopards will react? We certainly don't. I've given up trying to predict what leopards are going to do at any one point in time. Could be anything. They could share kills, they could fight. Xongile and Mvula shared a kill and then had a scrap over it and then moved on. Michael, on the subject of different characters and personalities, you want to know why is it that quarantine, I think you want to know, why is it that quarantine has stayed quite close to Kunuma and in this territory, whilst Kunuma is dispersing and has moved quite far away and is actually moving around quite a great deal more than quarantine. Again, I think it's entirely circumstantial and it depends upon where the young males end up. I also think it's character driven. I think you get two different personalities in every single litter. From what I understand, Kunuma is slightly smaller, but I mean that could have changed. He might have gone through a growth spurt, but always had the slightly more dominant personality of the two brothers. Slightly, he was always a bit snarly, that I will say. In my two encounters with him, he growled at me twice. And he's been known to randomly get up, charge vehicles, and then lie back down again right next to them. Just kind of establishing his own boundaries. I don't know if it's a personality-driven thing, circumstances. Quarantine happened to stumble across a patch where he was tolerated by Shumbambalana, whilst Kunuma kept walking to explore. It might even still be that quarantine disappears from our traverse area. He might go into Mala Mala, he might go into Kruger. He's still too young to be firmly settled. I mean, I've heard that Kunuma's been doing some very interesting things on Londolozi, but he might have just found himself a vacuum in that particular spot. I don't know. I also find it interesting the way that Xongile has gone all the way into Kruger before, all the way back again, hangs out around his natal spot where he was raised, constantly, and then all of a sudden moves off again. There's so many pressures in these animals' lives. Alright, I don't think quarantine's going to do terribly much more. We will try and sort out our comms issues and come back here on the sunset safari. But for now, I'm going to head back in the direction of Juma. Let's head across there now, though, and go and have a look at who's getting a chance to feed on the impala carcass.
Well, Karula's on the carcass. That. There we go, she's actually drinking, but it looks like little Hosana is stalking his sister. So the sister is just through the bush there. What's he up to? Is he going to play with his sister, or is he just finding a spot where he can lie down? Okay, his sister's just behind that tree he's about to go behind. There she is. Swat, swat. Let's see if she feels harassed enough to move. A serious young lady. Pounce. Let's see how long it takes before she gets annoyed with him. If I go back, it'll be a bit better, Jandre. I can't go forward. Yebo. She's covering up stomach content and blood to stop smell. So anyway, that's what Karula's doing in front of us. Well, she's finished doing now, and she's walking to lie down. I'm just going to move the vehicle a little bit, see if we can see those cubs a bit better. Oh, our Bendex is giving us problems. At least it's an easy fix. There we go. Hosan has rushed down. He's playing in the Mawati River. Oh, sorry, Jandro. I'm trying to get it. So we just saw him diving down into the Mawati. He's playing stork things. He's, there he is. Bobby's wondering, as you know, more and more leopards are born, won't their territories become smaller? With what happens with female leopards, especially the older they get, the smaller their territories get, and the more cubs they have, the smaller their territories get, as they keep giving sections of their territory off to female cubs. What a little horror. Having a grand old time. Hiding in, trying to make himself flat in the little white berry bushes. We're going to be incredibly spoiled for the next little while with these leopards. So, Bobby, what happens is, and with male territories it's a bit different from female territories. So as a female leopard has more and more female cubs, her territory shrinks. Until that's quite often towards the end of her life, when she's around 13, 14 years old, she's left with the worst part of her territory at a time when she's not actually that fit and healthy. So generally leads to a female leopard's demise. Males are a bit different. So what happens is males are normally hold domain for four or five, sometimes a bit longer, years over an area. And then there seems to be a switch, and they sort of swing and move into a slightly different territory. And this is an instinctive response to inbreeding. So by swinging a little bit into a different territory, I'm just going to move a little bit so you guys can see again. Make sure we don't fall off the... How's that, John? Right? Can we get his head? Yeah. There we go. So the males, after about 5 years of being dominant over an area, will generally shift their territory. It doesn't really matter which direction, but a little bit away from where their core has been. And that's mostly to try stop them breeding with their daughters. And that's a little instinctive thing. So they do it without really even knowing that they need to push away from where they're more likely to have lots of offspring. Then again, when they get to sort of 11, 12, they come under pressure from a younger male, normally five, six years old, who's coming into an area, and we'll push them in, and they'll become like a mvula. He sort of lives on the peripheries at the moment, avoiding conflict as best he can. Oh, it's tired kitty now. Nice cool sand, fat belly. What more could you want as a young leopard? Now, Tanner is wondering, how old are big cat cubs when they go on their first hunt with their mom? Well, they don't really go hunting with their mother. They might be there when she makes a kill, but generally they're left separate. And they don't need to be taught how to hunt. They're instinctive hunters. They have that knowledge ingrained in them. But it could be as young as 3 weeks, or no, sorry, not 3 weeks, 3 months. if they're following her and she happens to see something, she happens to kill it. They don't really learn from that. They are instinctive hunters. They don't need to be taught. So mothers will generally leave them when they go hunting because they're a bit of a pain when you go hunting. They normally will make their first kill between 3 and 6 months. It'll be something small, a lizard or a squirrel or something like that. Apart from, of course, the many butterflies and moths and grasshoppers they murder before then. But generally their first big kill will be big-ish kill will be around that sort of 6 month period. The first major animal like a impala or a dike or something will be after a year old. Yeah, let's move to go see if we can see Xongile. You got her there, Vijandra. We'll try to get a bit closer, but she's... Here we go. Hosana has actually come to join little Xongile next to her leadwood stump. Now, oh, look at that. Isn't that just too sweet? Jerry in Canada is wondering, what becomes of the rest of the carcass after the leopards are finished with it? So, you might get lots of different scavengers feeding off. Hyena might finish it off, and vultures if they spot it. Battalier, tawny eagle. See their ears popping up. Just look at that paw on the sitting there. Look at that. There's not her paw just sitting up on the log there. Now Mick1011 is wondering, do these cats ever scratch at tree bark and that? They do. It's very important for them to do that because it helps them clean their nails. You've got to be cleanly, because otherwise, I mean, underneath a leopard's nails is not very, very hygienic. It's filled with quite a lot of rotten flesh and such. Oh, there's little Xongi. Oh, she likes that leadwood log, that one. It's a good pillow. It's all settling down here. They've all got full bellies, lots of meat still around. Temperature's getting warmer. Still quite chilly with the window. Okay, well, we sit here and wait to see what happens next with Karula and the two cubs. Let's go back to Jamie and see how she's been faring down on Cheetah Plains.
We are almost out of Cheetah Plains, in fact, making our way back towards Juma, where I can hear your questions properly and we can go and search for the Nkuhumas. I have a funny feeling we're going to find them somewhere on a kill. And I have a funny feeling it'll probably... I think let's head across there and find out exactly what they were up to last night. The Nkuhumas have been unstoppable over the last few days, catching buffalo after buffalo after buffalo, two in 24 hours. I have no doubt they're going to be around. I'm going to figure out exactly what's happening there. Yesterday on the sunset safari, the young lioness was with one of the Birmingham boys. But he definitely wasn't getting anywhere with her yesterday. Both of them were thoroughly asleep. Sorry. What was that? Where did I see it? Oh. I'm not sure I want to pick that up. I was about to, but now I'm not 100% sure if it doesn't come from a piece of scat. It's a bundle of fur. I wonder where that came from. Oh, very interesting. It must have blown here, presumably, with this amount of wind. Perhaps a little bit from maybe Tundi's. No, it can't have blown all the way here from Tundi's Impala Kill. And just hop out 1 second. I just want to have a look. I don't want to touch it because it could also be a remainder from a piece of dried up lion scat or leopard scat that perhaps blew along here and separate from the rest. This is interesting. Proper chunk of fur. Actually, almost. Looks as though it could have come from a mane. Perhaps there was a scrap. No, I'm definitely not touching that. It's still gooey inside. Could also be a hairball that one of the cats coughed up. Perhaps a leopard or a lion stopped along the way. There's no tracks here, which still makes me think it's blown in this direction. Either way, thoroughly unhygienic. Having talked about quarantine and their digestive systems and internal parasites and bacteria, no thank you. Let's go and look at those zebra instead. Here we go. So we've got a breeding herd, or a harem actually is the correct terminology, of zebra. Now let's go and see how this social structure is playing out, because generally what you'll find is that the female will walk ahead, usually the highest ranking female. Let's see if that's what we've got here, or with the stallion walking behind. Nope, I'm actually wrong. It is not a harem at all. It's a young group of stallions, it's a bachelor herd. And these two little ones that are crossing the road, like this one, and here comes the second, they are still very, very young. They must have only just left the safety of their herd. I don't think I've ever seen a bachelor group with stallions this young. They're still colts, basically. I just need to shift out of the way. Obviously, there is a large white vehicle looking at me with disdain. No, I'm joking, not looking at me with disdain. Sorry, Zebbies. Just pop off the road. Oh, it's Shanae! Oh, and she's gone. Bye, Shanae. Welcome back. Shanae, by the way, is one of the guides who works at Nkoro. It'll be a name that's familiar with many of you, since she spent a lot of time before she came out to train as a guide, watching the live drives and chatting with the various viewers. It's truly wonderful to see her living out her dream. She seems so happy. Every time I see her, she's got a massive smile on her face. There the zebras are. Interesting. There's not all that much grass here on this particular patch of torchwood. But they seem to be doing just fine. All of the zebra now looking particularly healthy. I haven't seen a floppy mane in a long time. Which is, of course, the only way to see whether or not a zebra is unhealthy in any way, shape or form. Since they always look a bit rotund. But the best way to see if a zebra is in bad condition is when their mane starts to flop. Because they start to lose condition of the muscles, which means the tendons and so on that hold the mane upright start to flop over. A young group of stallions, it's the typical herd structure. They are herd animals. You very seldom see a zebra all on its own. You might every now and again see a male that's managed to set off on his own to go and search for his harem. There's yellow-billed or red-billed. Aww, red-billed. Not that there's anything wrong with red-billed. It's just I was hoping to see some yellow-billed oxpeckers today. The slightly rarer of the two species. Now, speaking of zebra manes, fox hat. You want to know if I've ever seen a zebra with an all-black mane? No, I haven't. I've never seen that in the wild. I've seen a zebra with barely any stripes around its legs and its bottom. You do, of course, get genetic differences, but I have never, ever seen a zebra with an all-black mane. I'm hesitant to say it's not possible, though, just because in terms of genetic differences, you probably find that there is somewhere in the world a zebra with a black mane. But I have never seen it personally. There are certain species that are more prone... How's it? How are you?
Morning.
Good morning. How are you?
Good,
thank you. Hi, everybody. Enjoy. Just chatting to one of the Simbabili guides, who looks thoroughly chuffed with life. Right, what was I talking about? Oh yes, melanism. You'll find that some species are more prone to melanism than others. Lions, for example, you don't find it in the wild, but you will find leucism. I'm not 100% sure about zebra and whether or not there are any with black manes out here in the wild. As we make our way back towards Juma, Brent, of course, is already there. Let's go and see whether or not the cubs have woken up from their slumber.
Definitely still snoozing. As you can see, little Xongile is using that leadwood stump as a very good pillow. It's a tired kitty, got a full belly. just too sweet. You can just see her brother behind her. He's also napping away. And Mom's off to our right, also fast asleep. Oh, there you go. Alexandra is wondering, how many cubs will a leopard have during its lifetime? Well, it all depends. Ooh, sun's quite bright there. It all depends. So on average, she'll have her first set of cubs at around 3 or 4 years old. And then normally on average, every 2 years from there. So 3, 6, 8, 10, 12, more or less. So generally, probably 5 sets of cubs. Now, this also depends on when, if they get killed. So probably say maybe 8 or 9 sets. Remember that leopard cubs have a 70% mortality rate when they are under a year old. Oh, they're still snoozing there. Are there any stations on standby for this Karula sighting? Such a tired little kitty. Oh, I can hear some elephants close by. I don't think we're going to have too much more action for now. I think everyone's got full bellies and is going to snooze. So why don't you guys let me know what you would like to do. Would you like us to stay here with Queen Karula and Hosana and Xongile? Would you like us to move on and go look for some elephants or maybe some lions? You can do that by using the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter or send us an email to questions@wildearth.tv. Now, Calvin's wondering, why do leopard, cheetah, and lions have spiky hair around their mouths? Well, it's not actually hair, it's called a whisker, or in big cats, it's called vibrissae. And they are sensory organs, and they are able to pick up little vibrations or changes in the air. Also, if they're moving through the bush, to stop them putting their heads into thorns and things like that. Is Mom up? No, everyone is fast asleep. You can just make out Karula through the bush behind me, and she is very much a very flat cat in the gwarri thicket. There we go, you can just see her belly there. Okay, we can't see the cubs from where we are now, they've gone completely flat. I'm going to just move back a little bit, see if we can see Karula. Lala would like to know, we said she knows Karula will try to protect her cubs from danger, but would the cubs try protect each other from danger? No, they wouldn't. I think it'd be pretty much each little leopard for itself and who could get away the fastest. I want to do a little bit of 25-point turn to get out of here. So it seems like the majority of people are voting to go find some elephants. Let's see if we can get one last look at Queen Karula, and then we're going to head to where I can hear those elephants breaking branches. Okay, there we go. So this is where we spotted her from initially. I think the view from the side is a little better. Not much though. There we go. Okay, let's go check for those elephants. They didn't sound too far away. Now, while we try to get towards those, well, they literally, I can hear them coming closer. Let's go see what Jamie's up to in the meantime.
Trundling along the eastern boundary, I'm going to try and see if we can't work out where those lions have gone. My goodness gracious, I'm seeing a lot of impala at the moment. We're seeing the mix, now that the rutting season is over, the breeding herds coming back together in massive numbers. And every time I pass a herd, there must be at least 40 to 50 individuals wandering around. And that's interesting because the males are still chasing the females round and round and round in circles. And the poor females, you can see the one on the right, are so pregnant. It's probably the last thought, the last thing on their mind, or the last desire, is to be chased around by a male that's definitely got his breeding seasons all mixed up. It's interesting, I've seen more conflict between male impala than I usually see at this time of year. We do occasionally get the false rut when the impala ewes start to give birth. But other than that, impala have a very strict breeding season. I'm not sure what it is, perhaps this strange weather has confused them in terms of when they should actually be mating with the females. Either way, for now, this particular herd has settled down and they're all quite comfortable and content feeding away and having their breakfast. I just want to see if I can catch up with that Nyala ram that's also part of this herd, weirdly enough. There he is at the back. Let's go forward a little bit and we can maybe get a better view of one of the most attractive antelope. Yesterday evening on the sunset safari, as we were trying to catch up with the Queen Karula when she went back to fetch her cubs, we had a procession line of five Nyala bulls all walking together. Such a wonderful sighting. All walking in a line. There we go. And a Nyala with an identity crisis. I think you'll probably find that last night he went for... Oopsie! Very good question from David in Napa while our Nyala carefully poses his leg up in the stinks that he's just tripped over, trying to pretend like he meant to do that. David would like to know what the white dots on the faces of the Nyala are for. They kind of look like tribal paint in a way, war paint. I don't fully know. I mean, typically white patterns on animals. There we go, we've got a female as well. Oh, sorry, mister. So I said you had an identity crisis, but you've actually got a lady with you. So typically the stripes and the spots are there as to break up the outline of the animal when they move through an area like this, especially in dense vegetation. For Nyala, they try and rely on their sort of, they're hidden rather than out in the open. The same applies to kudu and bushbuck. As to why it's on the face, well, that's an interesting question. Well, typically, white, apart from breaking up an outline, can be used to highlight facial expressions because, of course, the face is one of the most important parts that is involved in visual communication with other species. I don't know why the white dots on the face. I know they're beautiful. I know, of course, Teresa's lovely story about the white being where the creator reached down and touched the animal to help them stand up on their skinny legs with the stripes and the spots. They do almost look like fingerprints on some of them. But a good question. I don't know why that amount of white on the face. I'm trying to think why that might be. The females don't have it. The males do. I'm going to do some more research, David, and chat to other people and see if we can get a few theories going. And you're welcome to contribute with your theory as to why you think the Inyala bulls have white on their face. I can't think of a specific reason. It's visual communication and breaking up outlines. Those are the two main reasons behind coloration. Don't know. Good question. This is why I love these live safari drives. You get asked questions you don't know the answer to. Ah, another brilliant question. Another good thing to think about. I'm afraid our Inyala have moved off, otherwise I'd stop and look at them again. Curious one wants to know, why don't Inyala have purple tongues like giraffes, since they eat the same things? Essentially, they eat thorns. Why don't any of our antelope have... They do have slightly darker tongues than the predators, I will say that. I'm thinking. My brain is working furiously. I don't know the answer. Let's see what you two are up to. Very, very good question, curious one. Evolutionary tactics, I guess it just didn't work out that way, but I don't know why. You'd think that all of the animals, I mean, even elephants have bright pink tongues. What is it that makes giraffes special? What are you doing, squirrels? I think we interrupted something. I'm not sure whether we interrupted a fight or something slightly more affectionate. There are two of them there. Oh, hold on. Now they're moving away from each other. They're so cute. Oh, wow. Oh, that's incredible. Look at that. There's an agama there. Well spotted, Kirsty. Isn't that camouflage incredible? I am bark, I am bark, I am bark. I am not a lizard, I am bark. A tree agama, busy sunbathing, warming up in the heat of the morning light. There you go, now you can see it properly as it moves. Look at that. Two totally different species in one shot. And these are the same types of reptiles that you might have seen before on these live drives that can have vibrantly blue heads. An incredible coloration. Now this could be one of two things. This could be a female, obviously doesn't need the same bright coloration that the males do when they are breeding. Or it could be a male that's adopted a slightly different approach. So the males take two different approaches to life. One style is to be brightly coloured in blue and very sort of aggressive about displaying dominance. The other is to pretend to be a female, to look subtle and different coloured, the same colour as the female, and hopefully fool the other dominant males into thinking that it's of no consequence and no threat to them, and therefore manage to sneak in and mate with the females whenever the others are not looking. A standoff. Or perhaps just a friendly conversation between two neighbours. They're not in competition in any way. And they probably share residence in this tree. It's like a block of flats. It takes all sorts to make a home. A fascinating view that we have here. And those amazing clawed feet. You can see the really bristly scales and that colouring. And helps that lizard vanish into the tree bark. I wonder if it knows it's been spotted. And we're going to have more and more incredible reptile sightings just like this as summer starts to warm up and the rainy season comes through. You can see the squirrels also cold, also taking the opportunity to sunbathe a little bit. Look at his little feet gripping onto the bark. What's the baby squirrel in Connor's room called? Or Connor's old room called?
No, he came into my room
yesterday. Did he? Tato, the baby squirrel that has arrived at DRC, apparently came into Viam's room yesterday evening. What was it doing, Viam?
No, he just ran into the door and it saw me and ran out.
Ran in through the door. Yeah. Tato is a baby squirrel that lives in the Wendy house at DRC. And at one point, I believe, fell out of its nest and was rescued by Connor, who tried to put it back into the nest. Apparently, according to Connor, Mom was being quite useless. I'm trying to see if I can see that lizard again. But I think it's actually gone. The agama, sorry. Where'd it go? Huh. Is it there and just really well camouflaged? No. No, it's gone. The squirrel's moved back to its spot. Cool. This same albizia is where we had those incredible bush baby sightings at the start of our Mara week. And there's also at least two bush babies living in this tree. This tree is obviously the place to be. Much desired property, real estate on Juma's eastern boundary. I'm going to carry on looking for those lions. Let us see whether or not Brent has had any luck with his elephants.
Here we go. The Ellies were just up the road, very close to Karula. No more than, 100 meters or so. So it's the same herd we could hear feeding while we were sitting with the queen and her progeny. Nice little female there. They are slowly moving towards Karula, so we'll stick with them for now. See if they head down into the Mawati riverbed. Now, quite often we have some doubters out there, and Eddie the Medi, who's brand new, would like to know if this is live. It is, Eddie. I'm answering your question live from the middle of the African bush, sitting next to elephants. And not even 100 meters away is a female leopard with two cubs. And Jamie's out there looking for some lions. See how varied an elephant's diet is. That female was eating a bit of grass, now she's moving on to a bit of bush willow. Quite strong winds today. Quite a big group of elephants, and they stretch all behind us as well. Now, there's a female I haven't seen before coming through to the right. I hope she's going to step out into the open, but she's got quite a unique set of tusks. So she's got quite a long left tusk and then a slightly upturned right tusk. I actually haven't seen this female before, and we are experiencing an incredible amount of elephants at the moment around Juma. And these little ones come closer to us. Probably about just over a year old. You can see it's mastered the art of the trunk. Yes, hello. You're very scary. We are suitably scared, thank you. That little female, you can see the angular shape of her head. Oh, I say we're about to be surrounded. Look at this. I'm gonna do a bit of suck. What are you doing, silly? You're eating sand? Yes, spit it out. Yes, foof. Now, it's not uncommon for elephants to eat soil or sand. They do get certain nutrients from it. Minerals, iron, salt. You heard there's an elephant just behind us who's talking to the other elephants. This one's being very funny at the moment. Waving the trunk around. That's trying to get rid of the sand out of his trunk. Now, hello, James, who's in Canberra, Australia. And James is wondering, how do elephants identify? Oh, there's an elephant just behind us, don't worry. How do they identify which plants are edible, and how do they learn this? Well, a lot of it would have been learned a long time ago. And what are you doing now, elephant? Sorry, this one just keeps distracting me. And a lot of it would have been learned a long time ago, but probably trial and error. Now they are able to identify, I would say, mostly by smell is what they would identify as edible. They have incredible sense of smell in that very long trunk of theirs. I'm just going to roll down the road a little bit. Oh, we can hear them talking again. These are unbelievably massive animals that could easily flip over our vehicle. But if you read their body language correctly and you drive carefully and respectfully around them, you can see they just continue on with their day while completely ignoring you. Hi, guys. Quite often the little ones, the young ones, can be quite curious. Might come up to the vehicle. Here's a big female she's about. She's gonna push, is she gonna push down that little tree? She was thinking about it. Decided against it. Hello, big girl. It's okay. Good girl. Okay, there she goes. Sorry, Quill, I missed your question. I was just concentrating on watching her body language there. Oh, incoming little one. Yes, hello, scary. I hear them communicating all around us. Cool, I'll get your question in a second. Now, those low rumbles are just the ones we can hear. They have a multitude of frequencies that are well below what human beings can hear. Now, you'll notice that some of the elephants, well, this one hasn't quite got her tusks yet, but some of the elephants have broken tusks, and Quill in Louisiana is wondering, do they grow back? They'll continue to grow, but if they're really, really broken, they might grow a little bit, but they don't sort of grow back to the same shape. They'll always be quite misshapen after they break. And sometimes they might not grow back at all. Just depends on the depth of where those tusks were broken. So we're literally surrounded by elephants at the moment. It is wonderful to just spend time with these incredible animals. So I was just listening to the game drive radio for a second. Oh, hello. What you smelling? So, see an elephant pops its trunk up like that. She's giving us a good sniff. You can see she's the one with that slightly upturned trunk, tusk, and the long left tusk. Now, I haven't seen this elephant before. What's going on at the back behind her? Something going on there. And that big female, what is she doing? Is that a female? Oh, it looks... That's a female. It's a very massive elephant cow. I think it is a very big female. Look how she was backing away. I had to push a tree. Yeah. And you can see a lot of fallen trees all around us. And the majority of that is from elephants. Even this big tree right next to us was certainly pushed over. This one this size was definitely done by an elephant bull, though. Now, a lot of people consider this damage. I don't. It's elephant activity. And it's very, very good for the environment. So elephants are one of your keystone species that have the ability to change the environment around them. And for the last 10 years, we've had a very wet cycle. Copy, no problem. And we've had a very wet cycle. So a lot of the little bushes and trees we're seeing are all sort of under 10 years old. Now, the more trees and bushes you have, the less grass you have. And grass is actually a better thing to eat than trees and bushes, and with a higher nutrient value. So everything goes in cycles out here. So with the elephants heavy, because of the drought, the elephants have been very heavily feeding on the trees and bushes. And this will add nutrients to the soils. The termites break up all those trees and bushes, and it'll add open spaces for the grass to grow without competing for sun with the trees. So obviously trees over grass stops a lot of the sunlight getting through to them, and it can make the grass distribution a bit patchy. So a drought and then a little bit of rain like we've had, with the elephants really hammering the trees, is actually quite good for the bush. And it'll often increase your grazing species, impala, wildebeest, zebra, buffalo. So even though drought can be quite difficult to watch and quite sad, it is part of the natural system. Okay, we're gonna trundle on, see what else we can come across. And while we do that, it sounds like Jamie's found some more elephants.
We have indeed found more elephants. Well, we would have struggled hard to miss them, given that they're currently standing right in the middle of the road. And while we watch our elephants feed, I want to go back to Curious One's question, because it's been vexing me while I've been driving along. So Curious One's question was, why do giraffe have purple tongues, but none of the other antelope species that are browsers and eat thorns do? Now, my conclusion was that because the antelope that browse are slightly smaller than the giraffe, they don't need to eat as much as the giraffe do. And therefore, because they've got smaller heads and more nimble lips, they can actually afford to be slightly more selective about the leaves that they grab. And therefore, their mouths don't need to be as tough. That doesn't explain why elephants have pink tongues. The only thing I can think there is that it's some kind of, I guess you'd call it divergent evolution, that two different animal species have evolved different solutions to the same problem. So, I mean, elephants are completely indiscriminate about, not completely indiscriminate about what they eat, but for the most part, you'll see them grab a branch full of spiky thorns, or even spines in the case of the Dicrostachys or the sickle bush trees, and they seem to be impervious to it. So I don't know exactly how the cell on the epidermis on the inside of their mouth is strengthened. Oh, excuse you. What's up, elephants? But it must be thickened and toughened in some other way that doesn't make it dark. And no, it's just a thought. I don't actually have the answer. It's just what I've been thinking about while I've been trundling along and watching these elephants feed around the spikethorn thicket. I would reposition, but I think that would be a relatively bad call at this point. It's a windy day, which always tends to make elephants slightly more on edge. And if I reposition now, I'm going to separate the mother from that little calf that crossed in front of us, which you don't really want to do. So we'll just sit patiently here and enjoy the view that we have. They are slowly but surely moving out of my way. All of the animals out here have the right of way. It is their home and not mine. Well, it is my home, but it's more their home than it is mine. Little one, feeding off the spike thorns, giving us the perfect opportunity to have a look at their amazing feet and their toenails. Look at that little residual. Is that the foot bending over a rock, or is that a toenail on the left? A strangely shaped one. I think it's the foot bending over a rock. I love this camera. It gives us the opportunity to have such amazing views of these creatures. Speaking of amazing views of this little one, Alexandra, you wanted to know how old elephants are when they grow tusks. And this is an interesting one because this is the tuskless elephant. It is old enough to have grown tusks, and yet it doesn't seem to be. Well, it might just be a late bloomer, a late developer, but generally you start seeing the tusks poking through at about 2.5 years old. And then by 3, they've got an inch or so sticking out from close to their trunk. I think this is the one that we were looking at as a tuskless elephant. There you can see the female's fully grown tusks. So from the age of about 3, they will start to grow. They do also have milk tusks that start to erupt when they are only a couple of months old, but they hardly ever pop out of the skin itself. So they usually fall out and are lost before anybody really has a chance to see them. But their permanent tusks will grow when they're about 3 and continue to grow throughout their lives unless something happens, if they're cracked or damaged or infected or something similar. Right, Madam Elephant, you're going to let us move forward. Somehow I don't think so. We'll just settle and wait. Now, speaking about the cold evening and the cold weather that we've been experiencing, David and Napa, you wanted to know what elephants will do to keep warm at night. Nothing really. There's not much that they can do. The babies might lie down, especially on a windy night, but generally elephants are constantly active, constantly feeding and constantly busy. Now, for the most part, their bodies retain heat very, very well. It's part of the trade-off of having a very small surface area to volume ratio. So they've got less skin exposed to the volume of their bodies compared to something smaller like a leopard, for example. But most of these animals are very good at keeping themselves warm. It's keeping cool that is the real challenge out here. And cold doesn't seem to bother them. And in fact, some of our best elephant sightings have been in cold weather because they just have more energy. They're just happier, they're more comfortable, and they're often far less grumpy. Although that being said, the wind is always a factor. I've got no view of the elephants now except for one's bottom, but I'm reluctant to move forward until this cow moves off. She's just hidden behind this weeping wattle. I don't want to separate her from the rest of the herd. Hey, big girl. She doesn't look like she's going anywhere. Adriana, you wanted to know, while we look at our beautiful elephants, one of my favorite animals to spend time with, if African elephants are endangered. Yes, critically. They are endangered species. I don't think, according to the ICUN Red List, that they are labeled as critically endangered, but they are definitely labeled as vulnerable. In South Africa, that isn't the case. In South Africa, we've actually, depending upon who you speak to, which particular ecologist you speak to, in South Africa, in theory, you actually have too many elephants for certain populations. Because South Africa is made up of so many different smaller private reserves that are closed systems, that they have to control their elephant population through contraception or by moving elephants elsewhere. So in South Africa, they are fine. We have never had a major problem with elephant tusk poaching in the same way we have with rhino poaching. As you go further north into Africa, the situation gets more and more dire. The more unstable the country, the more at risk the elephants are, because very often the ivory trade is used as a funding for things like the ammunition and buying of arms and weaponry. Now, essentially, in places where you've got civil war, your poaching of elephants is going to be much, much higher. And of course, there's also the factor that she doesn't seem to have looked up at us at all. Maybe I can just sneak forward a little bit, just for a slightly better view while we talk about this. So much for sneaking. Got stuck on a rock. Hello, big girl. How's your view there, Viam? Got her view. There we go. She seems okay. It's a very tragic thing that something so simple as a modified tooth can be something that human beings find so valuable. Completely escapes my understanding. I don't get it. I'm sure most of you, if you're watching these live safaris, presumably you don't get it either. Now, elephants in South Africa, thank goodness, are very well protected. But it is something that there's been a much debate upon, of course, with the conference, with the CITES conference that happened in Johannesburg recently, and the outcomes of that. And essentially, to put it in the blandest possible terms, in terms of their decisions, they decided not to put elephants on the Appendix 1, which is the total ban on trade of any elephant parts. It would include selling of old ivory, new ivory, anything like that. And the countries voted against listing them as an Appendix 1 species. They remain on Appendix 2. And that's just the objective view of the decision that they made. Look at that beautiful trunk. Tucked right up. Very good question from Maggie in Australia, speaking about their amazing tusks on a slightly happier topic. We've often seen elephants with broken tusks, and Maggie would like to know if a broken tusk hurts the elephant, and how far out does the root extend? A broken tusk, if it's the tip, as you guessed, if it is the tip, it probably doesn't hurt them, although the process of breaking it probably did. If that crack goes, if there is a crack or a break that is close to the lip or where the tusk comes out, then probably I would say, I'm guessing, that nerve probably extends about an inch or so outside of where that tooth sits. But the worst part of that is when ability to speak is no longer here. If that elephant has a cracked tusk and infection spreads into the root canal itself, then it becomes exceptionally painful for that elephant. Picture the worst toothache you've ever had, and we all know what toothache feels like, some of you worse than others. You know how it goes right into your head, all down your neck. Imagine that, but imagine how deep the root system of an elephant's tusks have to extend in order to hold that tusk in place. Much, much longer than our teeth. Just think of how incredibly painful it is. And a lot of unexplained elephant aggression towards people has recently... Oh, she is actually missing the bit of her trunk. I didn't realize. I thought it looked a bit odd, but the sun's in my eyes and I couldn't see it properly. Okay. Is this the female with the... This isn't two-third trunk, Ellie. This isn't the stumpy-trunked elephant. But she does have a stumpy trunk. Hey, big girl. This is a different elephant. So that's speaking of sad things and the... let me just finish my thought before we go on to that trunk. And speaking of tusks and toothache, as I said, a lot of unexplained aggression is then explained by the fact that the elephant actually has a terrible headache and a terribly painful tooth. Right, so going back to threats to elephants, that stumpy trunk that she has, she's missing the tip of her tongue. Well, that could have been caused in one of two ways, most likely, but the most likely reason behind it is a very sad situation. She probably stumbled into a snare that had been set out for bushmeat poachers, by bushmeat poachers, trying to catch things like antelope. They often have unintended victims, probably wrapped around her trunk and squeezed till the point that it lost circulation, became infected, and the tip of the trunk dropped off. As you can see, that's probably why she's actually stayed behind. It takes her longer to feed than it would an elephant with an intact tusk. That being said, she is perfectly healthy, and she is more than capable of existing with that trunk, the tip of the trunk missing. It's amazing how adaptable these creatures truly are, but it is sad to see. Trying to work this out. It's definitely not the same. It's not her herd. And the tusks are a little bit too thick for our two-thirds Ellie cow. We usually see one with a young calf, a six-month-old calf, a slightly older male calf, and then a fully grown but very young female. And that's the sort of the nucleus of that little herd. And this isn't the design that we've got here, unless she's joined up with another group, but I don't think so. I think this is a different... I don't think it's her. I think this is a different elephant cow. Shame, girl. and yet she bears us no ill will. Perfectly content for us to sit in her company. Very special. All right, let's head across to Brent and find out what he's up to. Perhaps he's had more luck with the lions.
Okay, we're back. We have left the elephants. And I was just looking at some lion tracks, trying to figure out which way they went. So they were all around the edge of quarantine here. Just trying to see the last tracks. It looked like they were heading north. All over, they've been chasing each other, playing. Let's have a look down this road. Hi, Logan. Logan would like to know what creature in our area is the rarest or the hardest to find. There we go, you can see those lion tracks going down. Someone has driven over them though. Don't see any tracks of the cubs. Logan, I am getting to your question. I'm just trying to figure out what's going on here. Okay. Let's just slowly meander down this way. Okay, so on the antelope front, I'd say the most rare and hardest to find is probably the sable antelope. On the predator front, caracal. But I think probably the rarest and most hard to find here is a striped weasel. I've only ever seen them once in the Sabi Sands. And birds lost. But it's quite a difficult one. I mean, a lot of the snakes are quite difficult to find, and even though they might not be rare, a lot of them live under the ground. Let's see where Jamie's checking quickly. Jamie. What area are you checking at the moment? Okay, Colin, so I'm checking Warburg's Eagle at the moment. There's tracks up at the top, but nothing coming down towards. So I'm going to go around and check that Jigga road. Oh, yeah. I'm back. So I just wanted to make sure that Jamie and I were not covering the same ground. So can we find the incredible Inkahumas in the last 11 minutes of drive? I hope so. What do you think, Chandra? I think they could be in this block here. So I'm going to zoot around to the next little road. So I'm not seeing any tracks here. Now it is turning into be quite a sunny day after quite a cold, cloudy start. As you can see, I've still got my jacket on because there's a very chilly wind that's blowing through the bush this morning. Hi, Sharon in Illinois. Sharon is wondering, do the animals smell the cooking from our camp and come have a look? Not really, no, Sharon. Most of them will avoid it. Sorry, I hear a bird calling. I'm just trying to see if I can spot it. No. Yes. Okay, swing 90 degrees. Oh, you little devil. No, there he's landed again. Keep in that little... Oh, there he goes. Oh, can you get there, Andre? Is there, there's two of them here, right? They're so pretty. Go, 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 Andre, go. Oh, one flew, but the other one's there. Oh, there they are. There they are. Can you see them?
No.
Okay. Right. It's behind the light.
Oh, you terrible, terrible.
What? Don't fly away while I move.
I think maybe forward might be.
Let's see if I can see it. Yes, there. There we go. Ah, little white-bellied sunbird, aren't they pretty? Oh, foof.
And fast.
Gonski. You still got one?
No.
Yay, sunbird! Little white-bellied sunbird. But let's go from the tiny to the massive with Jamie.
Well, tiny. Oh, look. Oh, that's so sweet. It's nap time here with our wonderful elephant herd. Two little babies have gone straight to sleep on the banks of a drainage line or a river system with mom and grandmother standing guard. That is so special. It's so special, I actually don't... We might have to sit here until they wake up. I feel terrible waking them up. Oh, it's so cute. Both absolutely passed out, fast asleep. Interestingly enough, lying with gravity, pulling with their heads down, facing towards the slope, which is odd. I would have expected them to lie the opposite way. And it just goes to show, we often get asked, do elephants lie down to sleep? Or how often do elephants sleep? The little ones will lie down and sleep for up to an hour at a time. They've got lots of growing to do. So it makes sense that this is at a regular nap time, just like children, is a necessity in their lives. And they're saying something to each other. The biggest elephant, the biggest female who's standing guard, is rumbling, that deep, low, rumbling sound. I'd love to know what she is saying. When we arrived, Granny was napping as well. She was standing up against that dead leadwood tree with her head resting on it. Generally, the adults don't lie down as often as the youngsters do. They can, but for the most part, they often doze with their heads resting on trees or leaning their bodies on trees. But just look at these two. Little male and a little female. It's too sweet. Elephant nap time. Passed out. I mean, they're both fine. They're both breathing quite happily. Tails swishing every now and again, but completely dead to the world. And they obviously feel so incredibly safe, as they should. There's no safer place to be than right in the center of an elephant herd with mom and aunts and grandmothers all protecting them. Oh, that's gorgeous. Comes one of the other big females. She will have been snacking and feeding. It's amazing. The whole herd just stops when it's nap time. Everybody stops. And if you're still awake, well, you'll have to just feed around the area until the babies are ready to go. And I'm tempted to sit here until, I wish we could, until the end. We'll only make it to the end of the sunrise safari. Oh, there's Granny leaning on the tree again. But one of my favorite things to watch in any elephant herd is when the adults wake the babies up and they go and they kick them gently and they sort of nudge them with their feet, and you can see the baby's total reluctance to wake up. It's like waking your kids up for school. And they sometimes even have a little tantrum, make a lot of noise about it. Such a peaceful scene. His mom stand, I think this is probably mom, the youngest calf, standing guard. She's also dozing. The elephant's quite capable of sleeping standing up. It's not even chewing, she's not even moving. Resting one foot over the other. We're so lucky to see moments like this. And that they feel comfortable enough in our presence that we can just sit and watch this. I can't believe how asleep these little ones are. I'd love to reposition to get you a different view of them, but I'm scared of waking them up. Such a restful way to end off a sunrise safari. Hey girls. And then off to the left of them is a little bull calf. I say little, yeah, he's still little. Who decided he was going to give us a little bit of nonsense on his way to join the rest of the group. He is too old for nap time. I'm going to continue to feed whilst the babies of the herd snooze away. But when he came walking up to us, he was giving us the full head shake display, running towards us and then getting scared and running back. This is why we love elephants so much. They're such characters. They play, they entertain themselves. They're just incredibly relatable from a human perspective. Looks like such an uncomfortable spot, but obviously that's the way to go. We've got flat elephants. So while we talk about flat cats all the time, now we've got flat elephants, which is unusual. Ray, these two little ones, of course, are in the infancy of their lives. You wanted to know how old an elephant can live to. It depends on whether or not they're in captivity. Their lifespans actually, I think, are shorter in captivity than in the wild. But in the wild, they can live up to between 45 and 60 years. They can live even longer than that, but that's a rare exception to that. You're usually looking at at 45 is when they get that last set of teeth. So that's why elephants die. Obviously they die of old age, but they go through six sets of molars in their lives because the constant eating constantly grinds them down, so they need to be replaced. And by the time they get to about 45, it's their final set. They don't have any more molars to replace it. It's ground down, and then at that point they start to lose condition due to natural old age, and then also due to the fact that they can't digest their food properly. But these little ones have got a long way before they get to that point. They're only on their first set of teeth, both of them. Still another five to go, and many, many years of learning and experience and being in the protected heart of the elephant herd. Too gorgeous for words. What a wonderful way to finish off our sunrise safari. And with this peaceful scene, it is now time for us to say goodbye as Granny rests herself against the leadwood tree. Gonk. Leaning on it. Oh, she's dozing. She's half awake. What a wonderful way to finish off. But unfortunately, it is time for us to finish off. But we do have exciting prospects for the sunset safari later on this afternoon. So a big thank you to Viam for his wonderful camera work as always, as well as to our lovely ladies Kirsty and Jerry in final control, and our tech team keeping the wheels spinning. And most importantly, thank you to all of you for joining us, for sending us through your questions and your comments, and for keeping us on our toes with all the questions and the comments that you send through. We'll catch up with you on the sunset safari, but until then it is a time for me to say goodbye. I think let's finish off with a view of this beautiful scene, because it is truly extraordinary.